I set up a Sandmeyer reaction. The Sandmeyer reaction is often used to prepare aryl halides from aryldiazonium salts using copper salts. Let's break it down. Aryldiazonium salts are usually prepared from the corresponding arylamines via diazotization, a process that involves sodium nitrate under acidic conditions. The most commonly employed Sandmeyer reactions are used for chlorination, bromination, cyanation, and hydroxylation. Also, the formation of aryl iodides can be achieved by adding potassium or sodium iodide, without the need for copper salts. For this experiment, I wanted to convert my aniline into the corresponding aryl bromide. Since there are several different conditions to set up this transformation, I decided to test several protocols to identify the optimal conditions for my substrate. In my first trial, I followed a protocol using the classical Sandmeyer conditions. This involved using sodium nitrite and copper wand bromide under acidic conditions. For the second trial, I tried an alternative protocol that I found while screening the chemist's cookbook. Hi everyone, I hope you're enjoying the content. This video is sponsored by me, and I have recently published a book called The Chemist's Cookbook. It is a book about named reactions and experimental procedures that you can use for studying or planning reactions to carry out in the lab, just like in this video. If you want to support this channel, please consider buying the book. You will find more information in the description down below. These experimental conditions make use of isoamyl nitrate instead of sodium nitrate for the diazotization of the arylamine and copper 2 bromide instead of copper 1. Here's what I did. I started with a vigorously stirred solution of hydrobromic acid. After adding my substrate, I cooled the mixture to 0C. Then, I slowly added an aqueous solution of sodium nitrite dropwise at 0C. After stirring for 30 minutes, I introduced copper 1 bromide dissolved in a 1-to-1 mixture of 40% hydrobromic acid and water. Once the addition was complete, I dried the pressure tube with paper tissue and placed it into a preheated heating block at 75C. I then let the mixture stir for an hour. In the meantime, I set up the second trial. Into a pressure tube charged with a magnetic stir bar, I added the substrate under an atmosphere of argon. After that, I dissolved the solid with DMF and switched on the stirring. Then, I added solid copper bromide into the solution, and the mixture became black. Finally, I added isoamyl nitrate using a micropipette and stirred the reaction mixture at 60C for 1 hour. I monitored both reactions by TLC, and after 1 hour, the starting material was fully consumed in both cases. However, the TLC plates also indicated the presence of impurities and byproducts. To identify the possible byproducts generated during the reaction, I ran UPLC analysis. From the first trial, the main impurities were phenol and the protodeamination product. In the second trial, the main impurities also included the deamination product and a bisbrominated product. Despite these byproducts, both reactions proceeded efficiently and were completed within an hour. Next, I opened the pressure tube and poured the reaction mixture into ice water containing sodium bicarbonate in order to neutralize the acidity of the reaction mixture. Then, I rinsed the tube with additional ethyl acetate. After that, I separated the organic layer from the aqueous layer using a separatory funnel. The aqueous layer presented this characteristic blue color due to the presence of copper salts. I dried the organic layer with sodium sulfate and filtered it through a cotton plug before evaporating the solvent. The crude product was then purified by flash column chromatography to determine the yield of the reaction on the isolated product. after determining the yield of both reactions, which was around 50% in each case, I decided to scale up the reaction using the conditions employing isoamyl nitrate and copper II bromide. This time, I decided to use a reflux condenser and a protective shield for additional precaution. Since nitrates like sodium nitrate or isoamyl nitrate are oxidizing agents, I had nearby an aqueous solution of sodium thiosulfate, which is a reducing agent, to quickly quench any excess of isoamyl nitrate remaining in the syringe and the needle after addition. Have you ever tried the Sandmeyer reaction? What conditions and reagents do you prefer? Let me know in the comments. Also, if you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and let me know your thoughts. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!